We will start on our next panel right away. In the interest of time, I invite Dhanya Rajendran, who has, as young as she is, amazing experience with political commentating, both in print media. A big hand, both in print media, New Indian Express, TV. She was a TV reporter for a long time, and now with the super successful, runaway success of the News Minute, I'm really looking forward to this. Dhanya, take it away.
Thank you. So I'll quickly invite my panelists because we are obviously running late. And I would like people to sit down because I request everyone to please sit down and listen to what the conversation is going to be. I would first like to request Sushmita Dev. She's the president of the All India Mahila Congress and a member of the Indian National Congress. Through her debates in the parliament, she's addressed several issues regarding the safety and security of women. She's also raised important issues, important questions on issues like reservation for women and sexual harassment of women at workplaces, and has taken some progressive initiatives like providing free sanitary napkins to women in Meghalaya. Thank you very much. I would like to next invite, you can sit. I would like to invite Malavika Avinash, an active politician, a dancer, and an actress born in Tamil Nadu. She graduated from the Bangalore University with a Bachelor of Law degree and aspires to make a difference through her political career, which began with her campaigning work for Sushma Swaraj in 1999 in Bellary. She re-entered politics in 2004 by campaigning for the BJP-JDU. She traveled across 21 constituencies in Karnataka for campaigning for BJP and was appointed as a spokesperson in 2013, and is quite a viral formula on social media because her her debates quite often go viral. I've seen on Facebook and stuff. I would now the senior most politician who will be on this panel is Badar Saeed. She is from Chennai, Tamil Nadu. She's a long time advocate. She was with the AIADMK, once a close confidant of J. Jayalalitha. In the 1980s, Badar had demanded the codification of the Muslim personal law. More recently, her intervention in the Shaira Banu case led to the August 2017 Supreme Court judgment that declared instant talaq as unconstitutional. I would now like to welcome my last guest, Ruth Manorama. She's a Dalit social activist from Bangalore who has actively crusaded for Dalit women rights, the rights of domestic, you can sit here, the rights of domestic workers and those in the unorganized labor sector, as well as urban slum dwellers. In 2006, she was awarded the Right Livelihood Award. She's also the General Secretary of Women's Voice Karnataka, the President of the National Alliance of Women, and the President of NFDW. Okay, so are there a lot of journalists here who are reporting on the session? Can you put your hands up, please, if there are people who are going to write copies? Okay, there are just two of you. So this is for the panelists also. You are from AIADMK, Congress, and the BJP. And Janata Dal. So we want to have a good conversation. So things that perhaps you say about party structures, if let's say Malavika says something about a party structure or Sushmita says something, let's not read that as to their criticism of their party and make that the headline for tomorrow. Instead, I think we should have a conversation about how party structures are impeding women. So this is not about pitching one party against the other, but a discussion on where it's going wrong and what we can do. So to the two journalists who are sitting here, this is just a conversation where each of these women think about party structures. Okay. The conversation we are going to have is about how party structures impede women. So my first question to all of you, and you don't have to address just within your party, you don't even have to take your own party's name, but do tell us how, when a woman, for example, enters an organized party, for example, someone wants to join the BJP, the Congress, the Janata Dal, or the AIADMK, is there a vision, a longevity, or that their careers can be fully based on politics? Is there any kind of thought put into it? Are people or do you have to have connections if you want to? Do you have to have godfathers, godmothers? How does the system really work as far as women are concerned and differently from what it works for men?
Good morning to everyone. And actually, only after I'm coming here that I know I am in this panel. I would have really loved, you know, women's reservation bill. Anyway, But no problem, I can talk. Neither I have, you know, father or uncles or, you know, boyfriends in the party that I had to come into the party. I think my specification is necessary because, like, I feel that women must enter into politics. Not only bring about transformation, but they should be from the movements. Movements who works for transformation, not just women. I think if you just women, you got to be just women in parties. So they will use you like a pickle in the party. So if you want to be a woman, you got to have certain experience in party. That doesn't matter. Like, there are a lot of aspirants to come in the party. We should also make room for them. I'm not saying. If you are a woman from the party, like I worked with the National Alliance of Women, we have trained 600 women how to enter into politics, either in parliament or in state assemblies. So I always said that instead of we are asking for tickets in the party, the political parties, whatever it is, from communist to right-wing parties, they must, you know, invite women in the movement. When I say women in the movement, it has a certain connotation. Women who have capabilities and capacities to bring about the change and to work for society. Somebody very nicely said, like, you really want to have power, money, status, and properties, you know, gathered. Like any other men, you can also do that. If you want to bring about transformation in society, I'm sure the parties will recognize. But the party structure is not so women-friendly. Like, I had a conversation with many leaders, top leaders, including Mrs. You know, Sonia Gandhi once. And she told me, Ruth, you know, I tell you something, my men are not giving me the list of women. I have said I have trained 600 women throughout the country. Therefore, they would, you know, we'll give you a list. Why don't you choose? And there are enough of capable women. So, in a sense, the party structure would like to have women. Yes, but women of top notches, people with money, people with certain style, people with, you know, coming from certain hierarchy of money, class, caste, and gender. Okay? Even if you see women, oh, yeah, there are women and all that, but you see that we are in the society. Madam, please take up this issue of women. I've been asking. There are women are put into jail now, you know. Some of the very active women are put into jail. Madam, please raise this question. No, madam, we can't raise. So I'm saying it's patriarchal. Definitely the party is completely patriarchal, though they like to have women. They also like women who are powerful women, not that weakly women. They also want very powerful women to represent the party.
Okay.
So I'm saying that, but the party structure is so divided. They don't like, you know, women. To be, there are general secretaries, there are vice president in party. You have a big man, and then, you know, for the state you have, structures are very clear. But anyway, women are very less. I am one of the general secretaries. But you see, the major decisions are done elsewhere. It is not taken, you know, in a council. It is very true. It's all done like, you know, you have
Like how in South Africa,
yes,
they decided in
and
the clubs.
Everything is
decided. I'll just go to the other panelists. One minute.
Right. Okay. Everything is decided outside. So, women have to accept it, even if you are a strong woman. But I.
It is not easy to interrupt a politician. I've just learned that. So two things that she said. Malavika, you wanted to speak next. She said that there are capable women, but there are still problems in our political parties, the way the structures are, that really don't allow even those capable women who enter these structures, not all, it's like a fight. So what do you think are the impediments in the structure?
Good morning to everyone and namaskara. It's indeed an honor to be part of this panel this morning, or should I say afternoon. And when Tara spoke to me about 2 months ago, I was indeed glad that, you know, she just did not write a Facebook post, but actually went after it and executed something like this, which would perhaps show a mirror to the entire political system, to all political parties, not to any one single party. And perhaps leaders might, you know, just about listen to what is going on amongst the women and what the women think of what's going on in the political parties. So I congratulate her and her entire team for having put this up. Let me also say here that I actually told Thara to invite two people to this conference today. One is Dinesh Gundurav, the other is Mr. Yediyurappa. I said, please have them sitting in the first row, not on the dais. Let them listen to the women and what the women think. I wish we could have done that, but I still see Professor Rajiv Gowda there. So thank you, sir, for coming. At least there's a man, a politician listening. It's not a complaint. I'm just suggesting what is most required, because we are always speaking between me and Motama. I've known her for many years from before I became a politician. But we've often discussed this just between us and said, "Yen madam, yalla party lo hige agatala." You know, it's not any one party. So it was only in that context. Coming back to Danya's question on how politics and political parties work, I think they work completely uniquely for each person, man or woman. Yeah. What is Sushmita's reality is certainly not my reality. She comes from a political family, I don't. The only thing we have in common is woman. We come from different regions, speak different languages, probably I don't know the caste, and we will be definitely from different castes, I would presume. So everything is unique about every politician. So let's take that into account. Yeah, so your struggle to that extent is individual. It can never be collective. But that's just the starting point. Now, once you enter a political party, it can be a collective fight, because there is a Mahila Morcha, there is a Mahila Congress, I'm sure there is a Mahila JDS. Is there a Mahila ADMK, ma'am? There must be. Okay, there is. The very question is, why is there a Mahila Congress or a Mahila Morcha or a Mahila JDS? Why are we not part of the parent body? The moment you're part of Mahila Morcha, they keep you out of the larger decision-making process. This is the reality of every political party. So there's no point. Me and Sushmita fight all the time on TV. You know, Tutu, Mehmeh, Congress, BJP. There's no point. Here we are a collective. I think we should address this collectively, not lose our purpose by putting ideology, you know, in between us and the womanhood that we are attempting to represent. And when it comes to actual fight from within the political party, I told you, it reduces to just you and the decision making. It's core committee in BJP, I'm sure it's a panel in Congress everywhere. So it's just between you and them. They look at two things, which has been discussed earlier: caste, cash, two things. You cannot fight that as on today, as we stand here now. So what then is the way forward? What happened in Panchayat? What happened in local bodies in Karnataka? There's 50% reservation in BBMP in every local body. There was a legislation brought forth to ensure that 50% is provided. And
you're saying reservation is the only way out?
Yes, that is the way forward.
Okay.
How else would you see so many women in BBMP? They may be wives or whoever, but they are still women. And someday they'll grow out of their cocoons and develop their own wings. So that is the only way forward. And there really is no dispute there. How we work that out, how we ensure that the consensus is built in parliament is the question. And this is perhaps the best way to do it. This is, I am presuming, a apolitical body, a non-partisan body. And therefore the pressure can be, completely unbiased. Otherwise, it's all by. Look at the Me Too, yeah? How the men destroyed it. Did you not see it? They just destroyed it because the women were not collective in fighting the fight.
Okay, so I would take it to Sushmita now. Two things. One, because our topic is how do party structures impede women, do address that. And the second thing, from something that Malavika said, in fact, Tara had also told me to specifically ask about this. The Mahila Morcha, the Mahila units of every party. Do you all have an option not to join that unit? And why are those units really there? Is it relegate women to one section, or do they really participate in the economic, political decisions of the party?
See, there are two ways of. Hello.
There are two. The structure. Do address the structure.
Yeah. See, there are two ways of looking at it. If you said you don't need a Mahila Morcha or a Mahila Congress, I mean, I'm in it. So I think I'm in a better position to talk about it, because I think 2 years back, I may not have been. The reality of Indian politics is not every woman is elite and empowered. So there is a section of the society who need a softer platform for girls to come in, where they don't necessarily have to face the harshness of rubbing shoulders with men straight away. You and I may keep saying equality, equality, but I'm sorry, there are a lot of women, younger girls, a certain section of a disempowered society who need a softer platform, not so aggressive, not so masculine. So I think Mahila Morcha, Youth Congress, NSUI, Juva Morcha, these are frontal organizations. You'll have Ruchi Gupta come in later in the day. So a frontal organization is really an entry point for younger people, a young girl who wants to join politics. I think neither the BJP or the Congress has a parent body which doesn't have women. Am I right? So our main bodies, in my case, the AICC has women in it. That's one aspect. But yes, I have to admit that sometimes it is counterproductive, because when you want to, when you want to simply not accommodate a woman, you'll say, why don't you go to the Mahila Morcha or Mahila Congress? So it works both ways. And the first thing Congress president told me when I took charge is, I said, what is it you want me to do with this organization? So he says, look, by the time you finish your tenure, if you haven't built at least 200 Sushmitas, then you've not delivered for me. So turn this platform into an entry point for women leaders to come into politics, thrive, and then we initiate them into the main body. So it depends on the vision. It depends on the vision and how you run that organization. You're talking about party structures. See, I'll tell you something. No structure is enough to bring women in. Don't we have enough laws saying don't rape women? Don't we have enough systemic things in place to say these are the things that tell us we are equal before the law? There are special legislations under Article 15 of the Constitution to protect women and children. See, the system has to work. That's the challenge. You understand? So today, if I put a clause in my party constitution saying 33% reservation for women in all committees or whatever, or bodies, my fear as a woman politician is it shouldn't turn into an optic. You understand? So what I'm saying, I consistently tell Congress president that there's one, I have asked him for a corpus fund where there should be actually an institution, something like what Professor Rajiv Gowda does, where you do capacity building. You see, you have to make, it's like, it's not enough to say, I'm not making a partisan comment, but it's not enough to say that if there's an asset attack on a woman, this is what the law is going to do to you. If you rape a child below 12, then it's a death penalty. It's not worked after the Verma Committee. We've all read the Verma Committee report. It's one of the most comprehensive reports ever written in India on women. But we are back to square one, and NCRB data tells us that. So the question is, I hope I'm not quoted anyway, but I'm saying it anyway. I think there has to be massive gender sensitization programs inside parties and outside parties at workplaces. Women cannot thrive in isolation from men. Today, there should have been 50% men in this room. You know what I'm saying? We cannot. Men and women are equal partners. You have to thrive together in a society, in an equal society. Women cannot. Okay, I'll give you a small example. She's right. I come from a political family. So when I was fighting for tickets in Karnataka, and Soumya, I fought for your ticket too, by the way. So when I fought for tickets, when I was told, oh, she's not going to win. Somebody in the earlier panel was saying this. I can't remember who. So I turned around and said, look, what guarantee was there that I was going to win till I had my father back me up? So if you men decide to back this woman up, she's going to win. Agar aap apni beti ko jita sakte, apni biwi ko jita sakte, to kisi aur ki beti aur biwi ko kyun nahi jita sakte, bhai? And lot of senior leaders came and said, Sushmita, you're the first dynast to talk about this. I said, I don't care, that's the real. I have a part to play as a Mahila Congress president. So, You are asking me about systemic changes. You're asking me about party changes. I just feel that we should do it. I'm not against it at all. But believe me, I have had enough women who said, sorry, I don't know Congress ka yahan agar koi hai, ki hame Mahila Congress, I don't want to leave Mahila Congress and go to the main body. We feel more useful in your organization. We don't want to be an optic anywhere. You see, so it's very nuanced. It's very nuanced. But I think we all agree. See, what is she was saying, she and I are always sort of in an adversarial position on television. But the fact is, the women's reservation bill, when it was passed in the Rajya Sabha, Congress and BJP voted together for it. In the last Lok Sabha manifesto of the BJP and Congress, 33% reservation was there. Okay, now, I mean, I don't want to get into why it hasn't happened. It should have happened. It must happen. We talk about all sorts of reforms. This is not a political reform. This is a social reform. You're depriving 50% of the women an opportunity in parliament. We have to do it, and I think we all have to work internally in our parties to fight for it. That's what I think.
Okay, so I'll go to Badar's side now. You work in a political party which was headed by a woman. Even then, the structures there, did it really encourage? I mean, is it a myth then that a woman at the leadership will make a change? That's one question to you. And the other, one of them said that 33% reservation is perhaps the only solution, but Sushmita thinks that there should be gender sensitization. What would you say is a solution to make parties more inclusive as far as women are concerned?
At the outset, congrats, Tara, because this was something which I was dreaming of. I'm a great dreamer. But I dreamt a lot about this, just to tell you a little bit about myself, about this triple talak being banned. And it came true. I didn't do much about it. I dreamt a lot. But I think when you dream a lot, I think even the universe conspires with you. As that book, that alchemist tells me, I love that. Anyway, sorry for saying all this. However, I don't think it makes a difference if a woman is at the top. And my story is so different. It's very sad, but also. Though I became an MLA, I stood for MP elections. I won the most number of votes in the MP elections from all the men and women put together. But then what happened to me is I came from the top. Very sad. Jayalalitha, madam, the late Jayalalitha just nominated me first as the chairman of the Minorities Commission, and this is chairman of the Work Board, which are pretty powerful positions. And the Work Board, when I was nominated, there were a lot of protests from the men, but she handled it very well. And I'm a great confrontationist. I never accept anything. Sorry to say, I fight a lot. It's no good. Sometimes you have to work. You have to work from within, they tell me. But I just can't do it. How long am I going to wait? You know, you work from within. When is that going to be? You know, so I feel right now it has to be done. However, so I joined there. And she put me in there and made me MLA and all over Tamil Nadu. They even knew how to pronounce my name. Badar is a very uncommon name. But then they were very nice for a while. And then they said, but why did you come here? We don't need people like you. You're speaking English. You don't even know enough Tamil. So I went out at that age of 60. I hate to tell you my age. That's not it now. Now it's much more. I went and I got a tutor and I taught in English and he wrote it in Tamil. And I started, big fonts I have, and I started reading it very boldly in the assembly. And they told me that, in a Hindi le padikringla. All of you who don't know Tamil, oh, you're reading it in Hindi, is it? Oh, okay. All right. You know, I faced so much of flack for coming in from the top. And I think is, I would never recommend to anybody that you should come in from the top. Because then you're in so much trouble. You know, you're just pushed from one, the pillar to the post. And you can't go and say anything. But before I would say anything, they would say, ah, there she goes. Now she's going to go and complain to Jayalalitha Amma. I would never be able to see her even for months. You know, who am I in the big scheme of things? A little drop in my ocean. Just lucky that she nominated me. Okay, and I won the elections. Now, during elections, Muslim area, that is, I mean, 25% maybe Salma, the triplicate constituency. Oh, this woman who's fighting all the time against the Muslim men, don't vote for her. was what the women were told. Then I would run behind each one and tell them some in Tamil, some in Urdu, my language, and some in Hindi and what have you. Say that, you know what, you need to come out and vote because otherwise everyone's going to get divorced here. So you have to come. So they say, yes, yes, madam, hum zarur aate. And on election day, they created such a furor. And they wouldn't allow these men, you know, women, you know, burqas and all to come. So I had to drop everything and said, wait, I'm going to go and meet all of them. During election day, this is. I went and quickly brought them and they all came. And they said, no, our men said, don't bother going out and voting. We're going to vote for her. Yeah, you know, some of them did vote, I must say. So they all came out and I was thrilled whether I won or I lost. I don't care. But they all came and voted for me, these women. And besides, it was also a Brahmin area where madam, you know, had a lot of pull. And I also had a little bit of it. I felt very proud. You know, we run an institution for college for girls in the family does in Chennai. So then they said, yeah, you gave us that seat. You remember? I capitalized on it very well. Yeah, yeah, I remember. You know, I had to win it, right? My concern was only that. I don't care what anyone has to say about me. And you know, if it's giving some men some sleepless nights, thinking about me, lovely. I like it. No tension. No, I'm not the average Muslim woman. Quite a brat. Anyway, so then they all came and I won against Karunanidhi's walking partner. Who is he, Salma? The guy who against whom I stood. And I won only by 1700 votes. But I loved it. 1700 to me was like 17,000 votes, you know.
No,
I
said, but tell us what happened after.
After, I was thrown out. Not by Amma, not by her. But there was a lot of pillow talk goes on, right? I hope there's not much of press here. And because I must say one thing. Yeah. The women were against women. That is the saddest part. When we stand for election, it's the truth. Believe me, it's the truth. The women are against another woman. How did you go up there when we are struggling here in the Mahila Mocha or whatever you have? Who are you to come and encroach on our space? The women say that, men also say that. Now, where do I belong? I don't know. But I made it for 5 years and then I was out of it. She, madam, did not know anything, but because maybe she didn't have a ear to the ground at that time. Sorry, I hope nobody's going to quote me on that, but she's dead and gone anyway. She was such a wonderful person. She was a charmer and she liked me. I was the poster girl for minorities, you know, and for doing all these things. I took great. I loved it, but I made it good. I, you know, held her flag high when I was chairman of AAC board. All 15 men sitting around me and I'm the only woman there. And you know, if I pass orders, they say, who is she? What does she know about mosques and dargahs? You know, but I did it anyway. I passed all the orders. Many of them went to the courts and they all got upheld. So now they hate me. I don't know whether I can ever stand in Tamil Nadu politics again. So it doesn't really matter if there is a woman at the helm of affairs. I believe very strongly. And secondly, I feel that, as she said, you need to have this gender sensitization for women. Somebody here said, yeah, only for women, because we need to tell them, no cash for vote. You can't take money. Let your husbands take, brothers, whoever. You don't take it. And you come out and vote for any woman who stands. It can be anybody, but vote. Once she's sitting there, she has suffered so much. She'll come around with more. So the one way I believe to get there, the path is,
okay,
reservation, definitely reservation, but we can't sit and wait for that. We
okay.
have to work.
Mother, so in this panel, I'm going to ask quick questions, very quick answers, because people also want to have an insight into party structures and how it works. So you don't have to specifically say this is how it works in my party, but very quick answers to also all people who aspire to be part of political parties. Do women, a large number of women in the party, have a say in the economic and political decisions of the party?
No, I think it entirely depends on, like I said, who sits in the parent body. BJP does have a 33% reservation for women within the parent body. Mm-hmm. They are the ones that make policy decisions, whether at the state level or the central level. And it is important to participate in all of them. When it comes to how do you join politics, I don't think there is any one formula. You just make up your mind. If you like what these people are talking about, whether it's BJP or Congress or JDS or whatever other party, if you think you belong there, you just go and enroll and start. There's no formula to how you start. Somebody may be parachuted. Somebody may come from grassroots. It's each one's individual path to walk. You just join the party and start working. And if you really, once you enter, you know how it works, how the structures work, how, you know, if you want a corporation ticket, what you do. If you want an assembly ticket, what you do. If you want a parliament, what you do. And then you start addressing your constituency. You go and start working there. There is no alternate to that, to being part of the people that you wish to represent. I don't think there's any alternate to that. Whether you're a man or a woman, you have to belong. When you're parachuted, then you start working backwards. You go back to the people and say, thank you for voting me. Now I'm going to vote for you. Please vote me back again. So the people's connect, I think you should make it so much so that it becomes irrefutable. And the party bosses will look at you, right? Hmm. They can't ignore you.
Sushmita, now economic and political decisions in the party. And second, ticket distribution system. You said you fought for 4 tickets in Karnataka. Are women powerful voices in the ticket distribution systems of parties?
See, I feel that the ticket distribution, see, politics is very competitive. Let's not undermine the power of that argument. And having said that, I mean, as a Mahila Congress president, I'm also, I also tell a lot of women that a ticket shouldn't come as an entitlement. Oh, I'm a woman, so give me a ticket. No. Because till there is reservation, you have to prove your competence. What hurts me is if a competent woman is refused a ticket. Okay, I just want to give Soumya's example. There was an argument that one family, one ticket. Right? Because her father was the former home minister, as you all know. And, you know, it was going to and fro, to and fro. You're asking me about ticket distribution. I'm giving you a small insight. And finally, I mean, I said to, you know, my high command, saying, look, it shouldn't be a qualification that she's someone's daughter, but surely you can't disqualify her because of that. And her seat was a tough seat. And my common sense told me that no one but her could have won it. What those reasons? So, in my eyes, she was competent. So if a competent girl like her is denied because of A, B, C, D reasons, that's what hurts me. But having said that, the basis of affirmative action, like we call it, reservation is a form of affirmative actions. The basis of it is that there is a need for an extra push. And parties must pay heed to that. So what, for instance, Congress president once told me, identify the women who won Sarpanch municipality three times, Sushmita. Identify them. Let's nurture them and let's say seats which are a little tough, women have an edge in seats like that. Let's start pushing for women like that. And I can tell you, I mean, I don't want to give the percentage, but we were actually given a undeclared quota. And I did have a say. And I can tell you something. The moment they give you a say in it, you also start scrutinizing women really hard, saying, does she deserve it? You know, kind of a thing. So any entitlement must come with the responsibility, even within a party, is what I'm saying. But I feel the more pertinent question is what you're saying, that why do we want to be political representatives? Because we want to have a voice on economic issues, on political issues. Like when the triple talaq bill came to parliament, it's fair to say that there was a Salman Khurshid and a Kapil Sibal ji and Veerappa Moili ji and Chidambaram ji all sitting in the round table, and there was me, you know, on the side, and I said, you know, whatever I had to say, so I had a say in it. So one thing I've not understood, I mean, why is it that the woman and child development minister is always a woman? That's one thing I've never understood. I mean, is it? Sorry? Yeah, even the center. Let me not undermine the power of that ministry. It's a very, very, very extremely important and critical ministry. There's no doubt about it. But that's what I'm saying. So you can't push people into, you know, gender roles.
Yeah.
So I should have a say in what the defense policy of the country is going to be. And
no, we do have a defense minister.
Yeah, I know that. I appreciate that. But the thing is, also what I'm saying, we've had a woman prime minister, but that doesn't mean every woman is empowered. So what I'm saying is that you have to let a Kapil Sibal or Chidambaram also run the woman and child dev. That's how we break the glass ceiling. So these things, but I think all changes come from the top. And I just hope that we can do what Justin Trudeau has done very soon in this country. And I believe it's going to happen. It's inevitable. It's going to happen.
So I'm going to quickly ask a question and then throw it to the audience and then we'll wrap it up. Yeah. Okay. Yes, that's what I'm coming to you. And also about, again, economic and political decisions of the party, are women given a role to discuss?
Every party, you know, operates on an ideology. It's not that they simply operate. They have an ideology, party ideology. In that party ideology, I feel very strongly, gender equality must be one component, definitely. Gender equality, that doesn't mean you have to have, for various reasons of comfortness, that you have youth congress, Mahila congress or Mahila JDS or something like that. But I think you need to create these spaces so that women can grow in it. I think that is essential. For new women who are coming, she feel comfortable to be in with the younger persons, with the young men and women. This is necessary. But I think in the party, in all structure, there should be sensitiveness from the top to the bottom that women need to be respected, number one. Women have capacities. They have to believe that. Please, you know, this is very not there. Maybe the top person will believe, yes, Ruth Manorama could be given a seat. She's a capable woman. But everybody in the party, like, you know, has to believe that she has something to contribute to the party. That is very important. And I think that a solidarity within the party, among women, is so essential in building leadership and also to participate. Like I am, you know, many times, you know, talk to the, you know, people at the top, because I know in the lower level you cannot talk to them. Eh, ogamma nivru sumne eno eno mattaadkondirthiya magila magila yaranta dalit dalitaranta ant helibirtare. But you can talk to the top person. But he says, okay, Ruth, give me some document, write document on every aspect, whether I liked it or not. I mean, Leela Devi Prasad and all that, you know, the great leaders of JDS. And they had enjoyed a very different position and different era that they were. Today, like, you know, very, very, you know, what you can say about it, we do not know. But I entered into an area, they called me. So on everything, on economic things, I write a note. On Dalit, you know, when there are discussion, one note. You know, on, you know, minority, a note. Women, one note. I mean, none other than the party chief had quoted my document and said that women's rights is human rights. Therefore, women's, you know, reservation bill must be passed. This was passed in the last Mahila, you know, that meeting of, you know, JDS. So improvements are there. But I think it has to be realized. They should articulate it. They should give, you know, positions to women. If you just talk, in Tamil we say, so I think we must realize these rights within the party. Gender sensitization, top to the bottom, to the pune, to the, you know, has to be done in the party. And it is very, very difficult. It's very difficult. If Leela Devi Prasad was not there, you know, there will be fully platform of men. They finally say, why are you sitting there, Manorama, come. But, you know, the body pushing this and all that doesn't allow. So I think in the party, the women, I'm trying to do that, but it has to be done. In the party, we must see to that, in a conducive atmosphere for women to participate, to take leadership, and to see to that, that we are not just, you know, objects there in the party, because many women also in the party like to be objects. But we have to say that we are not object, we are subjects in the party, so that it is a very long fight. But I think that these patriarchal structures definitely will have to be broken from women within the party and women outside the party. Ma- and I think in the women's movement earlier, that women standing outside and watching us is not useful. Okay. I think every
so
woman has to join in a party.
Right now and quickly go to three questions. For, yes, please, tell. And then I'll come to you. Yes. Yes, sure. Are you a non-politician?
You know, I was...
A party woman.
I was Karnataka State Women's Commission member. Ruth also was there. And I have my friends, Madhu and group and all these people. I want to embarrass you people as to why are you apologetic? If you have to break a structure, if the structure is there, if you have to break the male bastion, the structure, why don't you invade it? Rosa Parker, during you know the white supremacy, was, did not allow a seat in the bus. Where I mean, she didn't allow others to sit, but she said, "I will sit here. You will not." So you will have to be exemplary. You will have to take a lead. You will have to break it, invade it. Why are you apologetic saying, okay, if it has to come from top or from bottom? No. In constitution, we are equal, isn't it? Why don't you challenge that? You should say that if we are complementary to each other, if we are equal to each other, then it is my right. And not that you,
are
you should
do it. Are we too apologetic? Why are we not being more brash? Are we too apologetic? That's the question.
You know, I just want to say that, let me make it crystal clear. Inside my party, I'm not apologetic at all. But that doesn't mean I'm going to sit here and start discussing that. Believe me, I'm very vociferous about it. And but the nature of politics is such that I can't be standing on the streets and saying what I'm doing inside the party. But be rest assured, we are not apologetic. We are practical and yet we are convinced. I feel your frustration. I feel a sense of helplessness in your voice, but I'm sorry to say that there are enough of you sitting here who are not in the political system. There are lesser women in the job market. 65% of the unorganized sector is women, which means they're not in the formal sector. There are a lot of arenas all of you could be fighting in and don't have to be apologetic. So women, the status of women can't be just seen in terms of politics. Status of women has to be seen in a whole somewhere, everywhere. And I think all of you in your own fields have to fight and can't always badger politicians. I'm really sorry to say there's lots to be done in other fields. We are four women in politics. Be rest assured, we are four women in politics. And I cannot say more than the fact that...
No, him.
I mean... I know how much I've fought for women and I'll continue to do it. It's just that I'm not going to talk about it on an open platform. I'm happy to meet you over coffee after this.
Okay, Malavika, you want to add a quick one?
No, I think she said what she had to. These decision-making processes happen within four walls of a room and it's not easy to divulge the details of those right here because this is not a forum for to understand what goes on within the BJP or the Congress. But we are with you, which is why we are here. Why would Sushmita come all the way if she was not with you on this? So I think...
Okay, you have a question? Yes, him. One. He has to ask. He stood up first. Let him ask.
So as one of the handful of men in this room, this has been an enlightening experience. My question is, there was this point about women being at the top not really making a difference. So we have some kind of dissonance in India. We have a number of parties which are actually led by women and who are the unquestionable authority, whether it is the Trinamool Congress or the AIADMK or even the Congress for that matter. So what is typically the mindset of the leadership? Have they reconciled to the fact that just by being at the top, they cannot change it? What would, say, a Jayalalitha or a Sonia Gandhi actually think about it?
No, he's saying when there is a woman leading a party like Jayalalitha or Mayawati or Mamata or Sonia Gandhi, have they reconciled to the fact that perhaps structural changes are not...
Because if they impose something, it will invariably
structural
happen.
Structural changes are not going to make a difference because he's saying even women-led parties have not changed the structures. Is that because inherently those women leaders have understood that it's futile to...
Yeah, because
changes.
Are they also thinking like men? Are they also thinking
is
like...
Is that what you're asking?
Yes.
I understand. Sorry, you want...
Basically, because the women leaders realize that it's futile to change those structures to accommodate more women.
You know, there are two aspects to this question is what I feel. I'll try and answer to the best of my ability. See, it's very common, I shouldn't say it, but it's very common to women, for women to sit in positions of power and first thing they do is behave like men, right? It's like a woman with a mustache. Where's Lavanya is here. We went for a workshop, all my Mahila Congress office bearers, and to Gujarat, and we were 3 days in a room. In fact, we were conditioned to say, look, women work best in a collective, don't fight against each other. So I know what you're saying. But to say that despite the fact that women are sitting on top of the party leadership, they're not making any changes, is not true. But I agree with what ma'am is saying. It's a huge struggle. Just believe me, it's a huge struggle. Some things have to be imposed. So I would agree with you. I would agree with you that people sitting on top, doesn't matter whether it's a man or a woman, they simply have to impose it and it'll happen. And I believe, I was just whispering to her in her ears, there are so many instances I know about when lists of ministries have been sent back by our leaderships. Lists of nominations have been thrown back saying, change it, where are the women? But it's just that I can't give you a specific example, but it's not like they're blasé about it. They're on top and they don't care. But it's a fight against a mindset. It's a huge fight against the mindset. And it's not easy. It's not easy, but that doesn't mean we are going to give up. And I just think, I mean, I'm not going to speak anymore after this. Because my throat is beginning to hurt. But I'm just saying that, please understand, in the Constituent Assembly, most of you may know, when women's reservation was debated, every single woman in the Constituent Assembly opposed it. And why did they oppose it? Because they said 33%, what nonsense, after 70 years of independence, we may be at 60%. So why are you relegating us to 33% and we are in the exactly opposite situation, we are in 11%. So it is the mindset that we have not been able to change. And I think we need systemic changes which have to start right from primary education and have to go up to higher education and colleges. There is no other solution. And some of it has to be affirmative actions within the party and in parliament. I agree with that. And I am pushing for it and it will happen. Keep an eye on what I'm doing, okay?
Badal wants to make a point before
just
I go to the question.
Point,
and wrap
one
it
suggestion.
Up.
We've been hearing about this farmers' protest, how they're standing outside parliament and doing everything that they need to do, and saying that parliament needs to reserve 2-3 days to hear them out. Do you think it's possible that we can also do that? Why don't we protest, go out there in huge numbers? Delhi should be full only of us. And then say that we also demand a day of parliament just to debate this. And at the end of the day, hopefully, we will pass
Tara
the bill
is now
for
planning. Yeah, okay, so I'll just go to the last question, ma'am. 1 minute. Please ask. 1 minute, I'll come to you.
Ellaru namaskara. I am Parvati Shriram, Bengaluru Inda. But I am one question. Money matters should not come while contesting for the election. Why money is required? If a woman works or gents works
properly. Okay, and the next
properly.
Question, ma'am?
Next question is, see, when party, we go for election, we ask for a ticket, they will ask crores of rupees from the party. Is it right?
Okay, Malavika, is money the big issue?
No, money is an issue. I don't think you could refute it, but money is not the only issue. A lot of times political parties fund elections that they think are winnable and important. So it's both. They do ask you if you are wealthy enough to support yourself. But eventually, if you seem like a contender who will win, then the party supports you. So I don't think that really... Now, the idea here is to push for ourselves, not so much our caste or our cash balances. Yes, I think we need to push for ourselves as a collective. That is one part of the story. Let me just end this on a more positive note. A lot of people are not from Karnataka here, I would presume. And for those who are not from here, perhaps the oldest structured parliament that one can think of in Indian history is that of the Anubhava Mantapa from Karnataka. Yes, where there was equal participation. When there was a Basavanna, there was an Akka Mahadevi. And who better than Leela Devi R. Prasad to, you know, expound on what all the Sharaneyaru of those days did. I'm talking of 12th century. So that really is, I think, what we have to look back upon and to look forth. I think we have all of us for each other, standing shoulder to shoulder. And like she said, perhaps even a show of strength outside the parliament. Why not?
Okay, ma'am, she wanted to say, yes, she wanted to say. I think we'll end with this.
Very useful debate. My book will speak. I took 300 ladies to Delhi and fought for this reservation from Karnataka. I sat there 1 week. My book will speak. 1 week to get an appointment from the Prime Minister and other ministers. But still, we are hopeful. I think what you have suggested, not only this Shakti, our Shakti should flow in Delhi and we will have to sit there until it is passed in the parliament.
That seems like a plan now. Thank you very much to all the panelists. I know that there are a lot of questions, but if you can catch a few of them outside, you can ask those questions to them. Thank you very much.